The following program deals with a controversial subject. The theories expressed are not the only possible interpretation. Viewers are invited to make a judgment based on all available information.
This is your captain speaking. We are beginning our descent into madness.
And we are back to another edition of What's of the Rockies. I'm Frank. Thank you guys for sticking around. I know it's late for some of you, but boy, tonight we have a really, really, really exciting show tonight. Genevieve, how are you doing over there?
I'm doing well.
You're doing all right?
Trying to rail in my...
Oh, you're getting ready for this one?
Chicharinas.
This is going to be a really, really exciting show. I'm really looking forward to it. We have Jennifer Stein, who is the director of this new documentary based on the experience that Travis Walton went through in his abduction. But not only do we have Jennifer Stein tonight, we also have the man himself, Mr. Travis Walton. But I believe, Genevieve, you're a little better at doing introductions. So you know what? I'm just going to zip it and I'll let you do you. I think that's what the kids say.
Anyway, so yeah, the new documentary is called Travis, The True Story of Travis Walton. And as you said, you know, Jennifer Stein is the producer and director. And as most of our listeners should know by now, Travis Walton is somewhat of a legend, you know, when it comes to ufology.
Right.
Giving us a story that really compares to no other, the evidence and reports, you know, the first-hand accounts surrounding the case are completely startling, mystifying pretty much everyone worldwide still to this day. You know, it's no surprise that Jennifer was drawn to a case like this, and her production knowledge spans over 15 years, and she's always had a passion for ufology, which we can see even by the fact that she had her own UFO event back in 75, and ever since then she's been in this topic. She's won several EBE awards to date and even hosts her own television show. It's called Mainline MUFON. You can check that out on their website or on YouTube. Just type in Mainline MUFON, M-U-F-O-N. So we'll be discussing the documentary today and what they encountered along the way.
Let me bring in Jennifer. Jennifer, can you hear us okay?
I can hear you.
Awesome. And let me make sure that Travis can hear us okay. Travis, can you hear us okay?
Yes, I've heard all the foregoing.
Awesome. Thank you so much for joining us. You know, we're really excited about this because, I mean, here we are 40 years later. Travis, can you believe it's been 40 years since that event happened that changed your life?
Oh, it's just hard to believe so much time has gone by because in some ways it seems like yesterday.
You know, I remember being a kid and reading the story for the first time. And honestly, I tried to put myself in your shoes. Which is, I don't recommend for young kids because how can you even wrap your head around an experience like that? Jennifer, let me ask you this. How did you first hear about Travis and what happened to him?
Well, I think it was the Fire in the Sky movie.
That was the first time you were ever exposed to this account.
Yes, some friends told me about it and said, Jen, you have to go see it. And I think I saw it at that point.
Mm-hmm.
I had young kids and I was curious about the topic. I'd known I had a sighting myself, and I was fascinated by it.
And how did you get in touch with Travis? When did you reach out to Travis and talk about maybe doing something like this?
Well, I was assistant to a director for the Roswell UFO Conference. My dear friend, Peter Robbins, was working for the city of Roswell in 2010, and they were hosting Travis as a speaker. So I got the opportunity to have dinner with Travis.
Wow.
And we started to talk at that point about having a conference like the Roswell Conference up in Heber, because we thought Travis's story was just as significant as the Roswell story.
Of course.
And we knew what kind of an economic impact that Roswell Conference has in Roswell. I mean, 10,000 people annually converge on that small town every July 4th weekend to celebrate that story and the events that took place in that town.
Travis, you obviously have given countless interviews on radio and television, and you have been the subject of many articles and books. Have you been previously approached to do a documentary before Jennifer came along with her idea for this project?
Well, There's been a number of them over the years, but a lot of them are just, you know, like one segment out of, several things in an hour show. And
right.
There's not really enough time to do justice to the topic. So nothing quite so ambitious as what Jenner undertook.
Okay. I know that you had a bit of a difference of opinion, as many people did who are familiar with your story and your account, that read your book, etc. I know that the movie, which was a pretty successful Fire in the Sky, kind of took certain liberties and it didn't stick to the actual events that you experienced. So did you feel like this was a chance to actually tell your story finally in your own words?
Well, it's certainly an opportunity to set the record straight on some things. You know, most people are, aware that Hollywood always fictionalizes real-life stories. And so, you know, it's the nature of the beast. It comes with the territory. It nevertheless, really did open up people's minds in terms of being willing to take a look at the fact.
Right, right. And Jennifer, how did you go about starting this project? Because this is an event that happened, 40 years ago. Where does one begin trying to put the pieces together to start a project like this?
Well, honestly, Frank, it was really daunting to me. And I didn't start out with the belief or the idea that I would actually make this documentary. I started out at helping as a coach for Travis to organize a conference with a couple of other people, Peter Robbins, Ben Hansen, a couple of other people we were friends with that show up at an annual conference in Phoenix called the International UFO Congress. Mm-hmm. We actually started meeting there and planning a conference. We were planning maybe a 38th, 39th, and a 40th. The 39th happened, and the 40th will happen in a few weeks. So in the planning of this conference, we realized that we wanted to take people to the site that the event actually happened at. Mm-hmm. But it's difficult to get to. It's at, I think, 7,000 feet. It's a rocky road to get up there. If it's snowing or raining or the roads wash out, it may be difficult to get a van or bus up there with a group of people. So I had the bright idea, well, why don't we make a virtual film of the site? Let's take a tour of the site, make it like a virtual tour. And in the event that we've sold tickets, take people there, and we actually can't get them there because of the weather, we have a film we can show them in the comfort of a conference hall. Mm-hmm. And that's our backup.
Ah.
So that's how it started.
Okay. Okay. And Travis, I imagine you've gone back to the site where this event happened a few times by now. How does it feel going back there? I mean, the memories just come floating back of that night.
Always brings a very intense emotional feeling in me, even though, my interpretation of the event has sort of evolved over the years.
Mm-hmm. I know that one of the hardest things about this whole experience, like Ben said in the documentary, maybe it wasn't so much what you had to go through, but the ridicule and the criticism you endured afterwards. 40 years later, here we are, 2015. Have things changed for you in that regard?
Yes. When I wrote my first book, I actually said that people's reaction to it and the way that I was treated might have actually overshadowed the trauma of the event itself. But, things really have changed. I think that public perception has improved. Mm-hmm. Surveys show that belief in the phenomena has grown exponentially. And just locally, just when I go out every day, people mm-hmm. greet me in a very positive way now, and that's a far cry from what it was back then.
I must say, we had the pleasure of meeting you at the Contact in the Distant Conference, and you're one of the nicest guys, and like I said, I grew up reading your books, and it's almost a bit intimidating for me because, here's somebody that you've read so much about that went through a very extraordinary experience, and I mean, no pun intended, but you're probably one of the most down-to-earth guys I've ever met. Is it hard for you to maintain that kind of level of sobriety considering everything that is said about you and talked about you and has been the case for the last 40 years?
Yeah, that is a major point here, and I really had to make it one of the major goals of going forward. Mm-hmm. Dr. Harder put me on the phone with Betty Hill, and she had some advice about not letting the thing take over your life. And so I stuck to it and kept it from doing that. I had kids that I raised at home, and I didn't let it dominate the topic in the house. Not that it was a taboo subject, but just to try to have a normal upbringing for them kind of made it more normal for myself. But, you know, that's been quite a challenge. And some of the other crewmen, you know, in spite of the fact that they didn't go through quite what I did, have had their own share of difficulty, you know, dealing with people's reaction to it.
Well, yeah, and I wanted to talk about them in just a minute, but let me go to Jennifer real quick. Jennifer, when you started working on this project with Travis, is there something that maybe you learned or found out or maybe came to realize once you started talking to Travis and putting this project together that maybe you were not privy to before, that maybe, you know, those of us that, you know, read the books and just kind of seen some of the stories online didn't get from, you know, interacting with Travis in person?
That's a really good question. I certainly learned a lot more of the details that, of course, I had to do in order to really document this as well as it is documented. But I think what I really cherish from the project is realizing just what you said, Frank, what a real down-to-earth person Travis is. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what I tried to reveal in the film, that he appears to all of us, you know, larger than life, but in actuality, he's very much like you and I. And he was wonderful to work with. And I think that was one of the greatest gifts I took away from this is probably a lifetime friendship with Travis. At least I hope I had that. He's just a really special person to work with.
Travis, you were talking about some of the experiences that members of your team who witnessed what happened to you had to endure. And one that quickly comes to mind is Steve, who was the youngest of the group. And it seems like he kind of had to bear the brunt of it because of his age. And you hear the sheriff, Sheriff Gillespie, talk about how he seems, you know, like the weak one, pretty much. How has your relationship with Steve changed in these last 40 years?
You know, Steve was really, kind of wise in a way. I can't blame him for taking off, changing his name, and staying hidden out for about 30 years. But, you know, in spite of that, you know, so one of the major debunkers located him and offered him a bribe to try to discredit the incident. But I give Steve credit that he never gave in to the temptation because that was quite a lot of money he was being offered.
I was just going to say that I believe the amount was something like $10,000. I mean, I'm no economist, but
$10,000 in 1975 would have been really helped him out the situation he was in after losing our job like that.
And that's the crazy thing, because watching the documentary, you know, Steve says, you know, that he had some hard feelings towards you and that it was his family that kind of encouraged him to kind of reach out to you and make peace. How was that? Was it difficult? Was there any awkwardness, or was it just, you know, two old friends getting together again?
Well, I was eager to, you know, help him out any way I could. And, you know, his daughter was wondering why his name had been changed in the movie script. And so, you know, I wrote her a letter and, you know, impressed upon her, you know, the courage that Steve and the others had in returning that night, trying to rescue me. So, you know, I went to pretty great lengths, try to build him up to his daughter and make clear to her that he had an important role in this.
Yeah, definitely. Like I said, I don't think any of you guys had it easy going through so many polygraphs. And what can you tell me about the first time you went under hypnosis for this? Because on the documentary, and I really like this because you said that back then, you know, we didn't have the term PTSD. And that's pretty much what you were going through in those days. And they wanted you to take a polygraph and all this, but eventually you allowed yourself to undergo hypnosis. Was that difficult for you, making that decision and letting yourself be hypnotized?
Well, you know, it took a great deal of trust, but, you know, I did interacting with Dr. Harder and the Aerophenomena Research Organization team members. I developed the trust. And it turned out to be, you know, very well-placed stuff because the hypnosis was not the ordeal I expected. It was actually the main goal there was to separate my recall from this traumatic emotion that until that time, you know, I couldn't even finish a sentence. So, you know, it was a major milestone in terms of, you know, coming to terms and getting a grip on the fear to a much greater extent.
I see. I believe we've got Jennifer back on the line. Genevieve, I don't know if you want to rephrase that question real quick to Jennifer so we can get her answer.
Sure. My question was, what first got you involved and interested in the UFO investigative scene? And related to that, what do you feel you've gained and taken away from your involvement in a big story like that?
Well, I hadn't owned UFO event myself. Mm-hmm. And in 1975, actually, the same year that Travis's event took place.
Oh, wow.
And I had it in my gray box for about 25 years because I thought I was alone. Mm-hmm. And I realized 25 years after the fact that, no, I actually wasn't alone. Someone else who was staying in my house. It was one of those 5:30 in the morning, out the bedroom window, mm-hmm. Looking at a craft that was about 19 feet long, less than 500 feet away.
Wow.
It was pretty profound. And when I realized I wasn't alone and that it probably actually really happened, mm-hmm. then I began to give myself permission to start to explore and move into this field a little bit, because prior to that, I just kind of kept it in my gray box saying, well, I can't, you know, I don't know what to do about it. If I explore it, I don't know what it means. Mm-hmm. I don't know what contribution it can make to my life or I can make to the field. So I was very busy. I ran a number of businesses and I was raising kids too. So it just kind of was dormant for a long time. But when I finally stepped in to doing research and reading and exploring, mm-hmm. in around 1999, 2000, that's when I began to realize that this was really the most fascinating thing. It's what we all want to know. Who are we? Where are we from? Mm-hmm. Is there a connection we have to other beings? Is there life, you know, on other planets or other life we don't know about on this planet? And mm-hmm. do we interact? I was always a student of, interestingly, you know, of aspects of consciousness. I'm a yoga practitioner. I've been macrobiotic. I've been a big meditator. Mm-hmm. I've followed the work of Edgar Mitchell and studied psychic phenomenon and precognition and non-locality.
Oh, wow.
So I've primed to step in and explore. And mm-hmm. Over the years, I've realized that I can make a contribution. So I got involved in MUFON. I started a local group. I host speakers. I run conferences. I actually present and speak as well on things like ancient sites like Göbekli Tepe and places in Peru that I've been. And I also speak about my own UFO experience, and I speak about crop circles, which I've spent a lot of time exploring.
Oh,
so I think I've made a contribution to opening other people's minds.
Absolutely.
To the idea that the world's much bigger than we think.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Travis, one of the people that we've been fortunate enough to have on the show has been Stanton Freeman. He speaks very highly of you. We talked about your case. Probably the only other case that really can compare, and not 100% in my humble opinion, but it's the Betty and Barney Hill case. And the reason why I say it not completely is because obviously with you, Travis, we had, you know, a group of other witnesses that saw this happen. But Betty and Barney Hill, obviously the first big case. I don't know if you've heard, but it seems that there's a movie in the works regarding their abduction. Like I said, we're all familiar with Fire in the Sky, but has there been any attempt to remake Fire in the Sky, so to speak, and make it a little closer to what you actually experienced?
Well, I have hopes that that'll happen. I've collected the emails, and I encourage people to send more, from people expressing the desire, wishing that they had stayed closer to the actual story, and hoping that there would be a more accurate remake. So I think that's inevitable that one day that will happen. But right now, I'm in discussion with an enhanced version of the original movie.
Oh.
Blu-ray, high definition.
Oh, very cool.
With some commentary by me and mm-hmm. the screenwriter and some of the actors. Looking good that might happen.
Yeah, hopefully. I know I'd be one of many interested.
On that note, is there a specific email address that people can send in an email to now, maybe?
Yeah, can we email?
Get a campaign?
Remember, it's TravisWalton.com, you know?
Okay.
My personal email is TravisWalton@cable1.net, but mm-hmm. That's a little hard to remember than TravisWalton.com.
Yeah, no, okay. Because I'd totally be down for a special edition, with all the extras.
Yeah, well, and encouraging all our listeners right now to email in and
absolutely
get that campaign going.
Jennifer, let me ask you about a good buddy of ours is Ben Hansen. He's a great guy. Anytime I need a sobering mind to, you know, help me kind of navigate through some of the treacherous waters we encounter sometimes when you study these type of topics. How did you get in touch with Ben, and what was his role in this documentary?
Well, I have to credit Travis with that. Travis had actually reached out to Ben as well. And invited him to come up when we were starting to shoot for this virtual tour that we were putting together, which we actually did produce. It's a small piece Travis has for sale, and also my co-producer, Bob Terrio, here in Philadelphia has for sale. It's called Tracking Sky Fire. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you know, a walkthrough tour with some of the men from the crew with Travis.
Right.
And so Ben showed up. And then Ben, of course, has amazing camera equipment as well. And he started shooting and offered to let me use the footage in the documentary. And I was floored. I was very grateful. And we stuck up our friendship at that point, and it's continued. I really like Ben a lot. He's a really special
guy. Yeah, no, Ben, honestly, like I said, he's one of the coolest guys I've ever met, and really smart. And when it comes to these things, like I said, he's got a sharp mind. Travis, how did you meet Ben?
Well, he was good friends with another friend of mine, Dana Harbor. He was a former candidate for mayor of Mesa, Arizona. And I've just known Dana Harper since back when he had a cable access show, and I met him. We were doing a promotional thing for the movie through Paramount that located him, and I continued that friendship with Dana Harper, and he was friends with Ben, and he brought Ben up, and you know, I met him, and we hit it off.
Nice. And let me ask you something real quick. I haven't had the good fortune of visiting, you know, Snowflake, Arizona, but, you know, we can see in the documentary, it's a small town. You guys mentioned that it's a very, you know, it's a religious town. So obviously having a group of young men in the 70s come out with a story like this definitely kind of shook at the foundations of this small town in Arizona. I was watching the documentary, and I made a note that even Steve said that his mom to this day, she refused to believe the story, and she believes that the whole thing is of the devil. What are your thoughts, Travis? What do you make of this experience? Was it a good experience? Was it bad? How did you process that now?
My initial impression was, you know, pretty horrific, and, you know, just the shock and pain that was involved there. Mm-hmm. You know, and when I came to, I was still in a very injured state, and, you know, it felt very life-threatening, and probably was at that point. Mm-hmm. But it took me quite a number of years to realize that they probably, you know, didn't just take me aboard to do experiments or to torment me or to frighten me, but actually, it became necessary because I got so close that I got myself injured. Mm-hmm. I think that it was more of a rescue than an abduction. The nearest hospital was over an hour away, and, you know, it would have been fatal if they'd left me laying there.
That is something very interesting that I don't know how many people know about this abduction. Is it, well, like you said, you don't think of it as them trying to do something bad, but they were literally trying to save your life, and that is really interesting. One question that I got, or at least I was asked to pass on to you, is people obviously are fascinated with what happened inside the craft. And you describe in your book, the description you give, it's kind of your, what we come to know as these gray aliens. And a few moments later, you are then met by these other more human-looking beings with these clear helmets. But one of the questions I got asked is, were the gray aliens, did they have, you know, these black eyes as a lot of people see them? Because a lot of people point out that in your website, you have this gray alien with kind of like just a circular...
Yeah. Well, in the first place, we didn't have her gray back in 1975.
Uh-huh.
But I really do believe that what people call grays is really referring to what is probably a number of species that are New England related. You know, they have some superficial similarities being hairless and pale and, you know, very large eyes. But other than that, the overall structure of two arms, two legs, mm-hmm. the skeptics were quick to jump up and say, oh, life from other worlds, wouldn't be remotely close to a human form. And they just don't understand biology. They're, you know, I think that there's probably many forms, and they are going to look very similar. Anything that becomes tool-using and creates machines that can come here is going to have certain necessary characteristics in order to make that happen.
Yeah, it's true. Jennifer, I know that the documentary has been seen by a number of people by now. It's even won awards already. What has been the reception to this documentary of, you know, about Travis?
Well, I have to say I'm very pleased. I get email after email from people saying, well done. It's a real education and background, especially for the younger generations that seem to want their life in a soundbite, and they don't really pick up books and read as much as our generation did. And for them, they might only learn of the Travis story by watching a film. And maybe then they'll pick up a book and read it. So it's screened in many places around the world already. We've had screenings in Australia and in like Hawaii and in all across Canada. It was part of a tour called Modern Knowledge, and it's now in a lot of mainstream film festivals. I've put it in about 40 different film festivals just to see how it's going to do. And some, you know, you have to kind of read the instructions to make sure you're placing it correctly. Some have just, you know, said they're not accepting it, but others have accepted it, screened it, and it's won in two cases. It's won in Burbank. It won an official selection, which is kind of like an Academy Award nomination. You know, it means my film was one of five that were selected, maybe out of 40 or 60 documentaries that they were sent. And that's pretty good. So it's, they say you can use official selection as actually like an award category.
Oh, wow.
And it also got an official selection in Long Island at a film festival there called the Chain Long Island Film Festival. And then it also won an award with them as well. It won what's called the Personal Story Documentary Film Award.
Wow.
So it's starting to kind of trickle out there. And that's that was my goal. If I could get it into mainstream film festivals and I could get it acknowledged, then it has a better chance of possibly selling to a network or something like that. And maybe even going more mainstream, which would, of course, you know, wake people up to the story, hopefully help Travis in his continuing life journey of sharing his story.
And Travis, how do you feel? I imagine that 40 years of living with this experience, how does it feel to see this portrayal of your story on film being so well received by so many?
It's very gratifying, you know. It does seem like things are finally, you know, coming around. You know, even back then, you know, I selected quotations from my book about, you know, eventually the truth will win out, and it seems that it is.
Like I said, of all the UFO cases, this is the one that, you know, from my childhood, I've always remember, and it's really fascinating. Jennifer, when you started getting everybody, you know, in line for interviews, was there anybody that was hesitant about participating in this project, considering the nature of it? I know that there's people who still don't believe Travis and the witnesses. Did you encounter any resistance from anyone at all when you approached them about giving their opinions on this story?
Well, yes. Some people were a little reluctant at first. Some people I actually didn't get, which I was hoping I was.
Oh, really?
Travis's wife, Dana, you know, I kept thinking she was going to come.
Right.
Maybe she would agree, but she was just too shy on the camera. One of the crew members wasn't really willing to come forward, and I trusted Travis on this case as much as I would very much like to have one of the other crew members. We couldn't get him, and we're also missing two crew members. And I think it's really important to, you know, get this story on film the way I've archived it, because time moves forward and we lose people. And most of the, like, I interviewed a polygrapher. I'm actually working on a revised edit of this film. And I wanted to get the current polygraph president of the American Polygraph Association. And at first, I think he was a little resistant, but that's not out for the public to see as yet. But, you know, once he looked at the data, once he looked at all of the polygraph not the tracings, but the reports on the tracings. He was very convinced and really wanted to be part of this project.
Wow.
Most of the ufologists I talked to were thrilled to be part of it, you know, jumped at the chance. But some of the crew members were a little, you know, hesitant, like, oh, again?
And right.
Are you going to make me look like a fool? And people are always suspicious of filmmakers because filmmakers can make them look like they don't know what they're talking about.
Right, right.
And that was my goal. But
I mean, I can understand their apprehension. It's such an amazing and strange tale. And Travis, people still have a hard time believing, in spite of the evidence, in spite of all of these, you know, polygraphs and whatnots. People, for some reason, you know, you still run into a couple who are not 100% on board with this. Why do you think that is? Do you think it's just like fear? Do you think there's people who are still afraid to just be open to the possibility that there's a lot more out there?
I've run into, about a year and a half or two, I'll get some email blast from somebody just unloading on me. But every time it's turned out to be some real young male, literally on the computer in his parents' basement. and it really is fear-based. And once I convince them, look, this is very, very unlikely to happen to you. And, you know, you're just reacting out of fear. And they turn around. It's amazing to me how often they, you know, turned apologetic after blasting me. I got one just last week the same way. But it's rare. You know, most everything is positive nowadays. And it's because a lot of the false rumors have been disproved over time. And a lot of the better evidence trickling out, people are realizing. And plus, you know, science is backing it up much better than it did. You know, they didn't even know of a single planet outside of this solar system. And now, just this last year, NASA made the pronouncement that it's now a virtual certainty that nearly every star has about a dozen planets. The skeptics were fond of saying back then that, even if there was life out there, they could never find us. Well, with our relatively primitive technology, we have a telescope that has identified dozens of possibly life-supporting planets going around stars within our galaxy. So if we know about them at our stage of development, certainly they've known about us for a very long time, even before they ever ventured here.
Let me ask you this, because you spoke about this at the 2014 Contact in the Desert conference. And Jennifer, I'm so happy to see that you guys included this in the documentary. And that's the finding of the growth of the trees in the area where the abduction took place. Let me start with Travis really quick. Travis, how did you guys find this evidence that's really, honestly, if everything that's out there is not enough, I think that this is proof that something extraordinary happened in those woods.
This was realized later because, you know, I didn't even know about it when Mike noticed it. We were out there doing an interview for Paramount to promote Fire in the Sky, and he noticed the change in the trees, and he never even said anything to anybody. He went back after the snow melted and took some core samples and was amazed to discover this phenomenon. But it's only recently when, you know, so many trees died because of the forest fire that went through there, we were able to get a complete cross-section of the trees and find out something even more intriguing, that this rapid growth was lopsided, that it was on the side of the tree towards where the craft had been. And, you know, the whole idea that radiation of any kind accelerate growth is kind of counterintuitive. But you would think that radiation destroys living things. But Ben Hansen did some research and discovered some papers that had been written on the Scots pine tree species surrounding the Chernobyl nuclear accident, and discovered that those trees had experienced accelerated growth.
That's huge. I know that you share those news with those of us who were in attendance at your talk at Contact in the Desert, and I remember just being a bit flabbergasted by it, really, because it was really, really amazing to see that, again, 40 years later, we're still learning things from what happened that night of November 5th, 1975. Jennifer, did you know about this evidence of the tree growth, or was this something that you were presented with and included in the documentary?
Well, I had heard Travis present a couple of times, so he's known about the rapid growth in the forest for probably 20 years, maybe even. Mm-hmm. But when I was up there filming with him, I was looking at the epicentric nature of this growth and that it was completely uneven and it was only on one side of the tree. And then I started to say, now, where was the craft? Where was the craft? And then I kept running around looking at all the trees going, oh, my gosh, it's growing in the direction where the craft was. I was absolutely stunned at this. We actually didn't emphasize this in this version of the film that's out because we were so excited by it. We didn't actually sit someone down and say, all right, explain this exactly the way it is.
I see.
But it's very evident when you stand there and look at these trees, which are now completely cut off. So you can sit on them, you know, you can look at them and see the whole surface of the tree, whereas before they were only taking core samples.
Right.
So it's visually very dramatic. Yeah, when Ben found the Scots Pine article, it was even more of a further white paper documenting that this is actually possible. That's when we got real excited.
And I wanted to ask Travis, I've seen pictures of you, back then when it happened, and, pictures of you now, and, you're in excellent shape, good sir. The craft seemed to have changed those trees. I know you've said before that one of the things that you notice is that you rarely, if ever, got sick. What did you notice change after you had that experience?
Well, of course, I had some stress-related symptoms for several months afterwards. But, as time went on, I started to notice that, the whole family gets sick and I didn't. But, I just figured it was, that I'd try a little harder to be healthy or something. But as time went on, it became more and more, curious. But I didn't want to say anything because I've always tried to stick to the things that I can document. There's a number of things in connection with this that are very, very interesting, but they're so amazing that I would be afraid to say anything about it unless I could document it in some way. So when I finally could go in and get the attendance printout from my employer to show that I hadn't called in sick one time in 38 years, then I felt like I could talk about it. But, there was still a little bit of a reluctance because, I never wanted to be the bug in the jar. It's not about me. It's about what happened.
Mm-hmm. Right, of course. Jennifer, in the documentary, you guys interviewed, as I mentioned earlier, Stanton Freeman. And he said a really excellent quote there that we see in practice a lot when we deal with these kind of topics and people will try to debunk it. And he said, if you can't attack the data, attack the people. I don't mean to kind of focus on anything negative, but have you had any, heavy criticisms because you decided to take on this project and do this?
There are a couple of comments that pop up on Facebook and that pop up on YouTube under the trailer that, she believes this crap and things like that.
Right.
And usually I just, take them down, off the YouTube site so people aren't, poorly influencing the situation. But I haven't had to undergo anything really in comparison to what Travis has had to deal with all of his life, and especially from Philip Klass.
The most negative comments usually come from the people who know the least about the case.
Very true.
The debunkers being the exception because they are aware of positive things, but they cover it up. They're very selective. They look for anything that will they think that will weigh against it. And if there's something that's weighs in favor of it, they'll change it to make it look like it comes down on the other side.
Yeah, it's true. Let me ask you this, Travis. I believe it was Steve, actually, that said it, referring to one of his brothers that I believe works in a university out there in New York. He said that his brother asked them, why would aliens, visit hardworking blue-collar guys as yourselves and not the more, I'm not quoting him in this part, but the implication is the more intellectual individuals in society.
I don't know that we were actually chosen. I think that these the activity is they have a preference for remote areas, and it just so happens that, you know, we're out in this remote area working.
Yeah.
There's some people that think we were selected, and, you know, even Steve has accused me of being chosen for some reason. It's more likely we just happened upon them and reacted in an unexpected way.
From hearing you talk and explain and go through that experience, I'm beginning to understand and see more of that. Because obviously, I mean, if you just read the book, I think a lot of us, I know I did, kind of just made this idea in our head that it was a typical abduction. They saw you there and, you know, wanted to grab you. And I know that Fire in the Sky maybe kind of helped perpetuate that idea a little bit. I know that we're running out of time with Travis, if you'd be so kind just to answer one last question before we let you go for the night. If they came back, and by they I mean the occupants of the craft, if they came back 40 years later, you know, if they came back tonight, and you got a chance to see them for a bit, what would you ask them?
Well, you know, I used to say I'd turn around and run the other direction, but, you know, now I'm realizing that the intention was not as negative as I thought and was probably actually benevolent. I would ask the, you know, it's always the why me, you know, was it because I was just dumb enough to get too close, or was there some reason we were chosen? There's a number of researchers who have seized upon the idea that many people in literature and science and even in the music industry have reported sightings or experiences that they felt inspired them in some way to be the creative, exceptional, you know, geniuses, quote unquote, that they later became. So that's a question that I would ask.
Just one more quick question. You know, how do you feel now that 40 years on, there's this, you know, acknowledgement, this huge event, a conference centering around this one experience? Do you feel some sort of relief in finally seeing this recognition, you know, people believing you and actually wanting to listen?
Yeah, it is a bit of a vindication, a partial redress of the past experience. You know, I would have to say that even yet, I'd rather the whole thing had never happened.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If I had it to do over again, I still would stay in the truck. But, you know, you have to go forward. You have to make the best of what you experience. And who knows what the future has to hold. You know, it's getting better.
Yeah, mm-hmm. it's definitely getting better. And honestly, I'm very glad to see things moving in that direction. Because this, to me, this case is very important, and I think that we should treat it with the seriousness it deserves. And I think as time has progressed, actually time has become our biggest ally in this, because as you guys have noted during this interview, you mentioned that people have been more receptive and more open to what happened to Travis. Travis-Walton.com is the website, correct, Travis? And that's where they can go to get more info. They can order your book from there as well, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Awesome. And then the Skyfire Summit, it's also coming up, and you're going to be there, obviously. And where can people check out information for that?
That's the website, real easy to remember, too, SkyfireSummit.com.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Travis. We really appreciate it. It's, you know, it's always a pleasure talking to you. Again, one of the nicest guys I've ever met. Definitely check out the website, check out the book, and check out the documentary. Travis, thank you so much for giving us time tonight to talk about this, and we wish you the best.
Thank you. Great show, Frank.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. And we still have Jennifer. Jennifer, can you hear us okay?
Yes, I can. I'm still here.
Awesome. All right, Jennifer. So we're going to just take a quick break. And we're going to come back. We're going to get into the nitty gritty, because one of the things I always regret not doing was going into movies. Not as an actor, honestly. I have a face for radio. I'm the epitome of it. But I always wanted to work in movies and make movies and do all that cool stuff. And documentaries is honestly one of my favorite genres. So we're going to pick your brain in regards to that in just a few minutes. So are you cool to hang out and just enjoy
Absolutely.
Some music with us?
Absolutely.
Awesome.
I'll
all right.
Be here.
Cool. So we're going to come back to Jennifer in just a minute. And we're going to play some tunes here. You know, we're talking about all this, you know, experiences. And one of the interesting things that happened to Travis is that he was gone for 5 days, right?
Mm-hmm.
And nobody was sure where he was. And when he came back, you know, he thought he had been gone for something like 2 or 3 hours. So it's basically your typical case of missing time. So if all goes well here, I'm going to play a little ditty. One of my favorite songs by KMFDM when they started using their name backwards and they were MDMFMK. This one's called Missing Time. Enjoy West of the Rockies on the Independent FM. Don't go away. We're going to be back here with Jennifer Stein, director of Travis, The True Story of Travis Walton. Here we go.
West of the Rockies with Frank.
What's up, guys? This is Jorge Diaz of Paranormal Activity, The Marked Ones, and you're listening to West of the Rockies with Frank. This portion of the show is sponsored by Haunted Orange County, your premier source for all things haunted in and around OC. From haunted history ghost walks to ghost group hunting expeditions at some of SoCal's most haunted destinations. Make your fall plans early and book an upcoming tour or investigation today. Visit hauntedoc.com.
All right, we are back to the second hour of West of the Rockies. I'm Frank. Thank you guys for sticking around. I know it's late, but we have an excellent show going on tonight. As always, I'm Engineer Frank on Twitter, West of the Rockies on Facebook. You can find the show at WOTR Radio on the old Twitter and check out the website WOTRradio.com. Genevieve Uwe on the old Twitter there. Mm-hmm. And always Thursday nights, Noetta Flavors at Noetta Flavors, O-U-R-S, the British way. Music, fun facts, requests, and all that good stuff. You don't want to miss it. We are joined tonight by Jennifer Stein, director of this excellent documentary, Travis, The True Story of Travis Walton.
Mm-hmm.
Jennifer, can you hear me okay?
I can hear you awesome. Just fine.
Jennifer, where can people find you online?
Well, if they go to my film website, it's On Wings, mm-hmm. and it's based on my maiden name. So there's an E in there, so I'll spell it. My maiden name was Wing, W-I-N-G-E. So I put an O-N on the front.
Ah.
Of that and an S on the back, and that's where On Wings came from.
Very
so
nice.
On Wings, O-N-W-I-N-G-E-S productions.com.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. And a quick mention, of course, we had Travis in the first hours. Big hello to him and a big thank you again for joining us tonight. You can find his website at travis-walton.com and check out skyfiresummit.com if you want to go and be part of this 40th anniversary event.
The lineup, honestly, I don't want to take too much away from it right now, but the lineup looks absolutely amazing. So if Jennifer Stein could tell us a bit about, you know, what this event will encompass, that'll be great.
Yeah, I don't have the website open in front of me, but mm-hmm. You probably can see who the speakers are. I know my dear friend from Northern California, Ruben Udiarte, who is a big MUFON person. He's the state director in California, and he's written a number of books. He will be there. I think his co-author, Noe Torres, will be there.
Ben Hansen, of course, he's going to be there.
Yeah, no, he's going to do a sky watch.
Yeah, Ben.
Right.
And I know that you also have Lee Spiegel from the Huffington Post, who obviously a lot of us know him. You know, a lot of us are familiar with his columns on the Huffington Post, where he talks a lot about this. Was it easy for you to get some of these people involved?
Well, Frank, it was very synchronistic. And when things line up synchronistically like that, you pay attention. At least I do.
Right, of course.
What happened is I'm, of course, involved in Pennsylvania MUFON, and mm-hmm. I was intricately involved behind the scenes in mm-hmm. setting up a conference that happened in Cherry Hill last summer. So it was our 2014 National Symposium.
Mm-hmm.
And Lee was one of our speakers. So was Ben Hansen. Stanton Friedman was supposed to be. Kathy Martin was there. So what I did is, and actually George Knapp was as well. I was hoping to get George while he was there at the conference.
Right.
I did not.
Mm-hmm.
But I just decided to take a hotel room, set it up like a studio, and shoot interviews with these guys back to back because they were all going to be in one place. Mm-hmm. And then see how I could use these interviews with some of the other interviews that I had already gotten, like with, you know, the gentleman who was the polygraph expert, Cy Gilson, and the police, sheriff at the time, Marlon Gillespie. I'd collected some of these other interviews. And of course, I had gotten Rich Dolan previously. Mm-hmm. I'd gone up to New York to get him, and I'd sat Travis down and I'd interviewed him. So I was starting to see how I could put this all in with some of the footage that Bob Terrio and I had shot before. And of course, Bob was with me, Bob Terrio, my co-producer. He was with me in Philadelphia. So that's how I got them. I just got them for the conference.
I noticed that in your logo, you used the at least I'm familiar with it by the name of the winged disc or the winged sun. But you have a very interesting little image there for your logo for On Wings Productions. Why did you pick that symbol in particular?
My maiden name is Wing, right? Mm-hmm. And when I started to do email, I decided that maybe I should pick up that maidenhood a little bit. When I got married, I took my husband's name, which was Stein, but I had been Jennifer Wing before that. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was time to kind of reconnect when internet came. You know, when email started back in 95 or so, I decided I would use my maiden name, but it wasn't enough letters. I had to add some letters.
Oh, wow.
I had to have like 8 letters instead of 5, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I came up with the O-N on the front and the S on the back. And that was just for email purposes.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So I just decided I would stick with it and keep it because it has a powerful, there's power to flight. Right. Stein is like a stone or a beer mug carved out of stone. Right. That's where the name Stein comes from. That's what it represents. So I wanted to embody that name because names are powerful about who we are and who we become. So it was natural to go for an icon representation of that, which was the winged disc. And of course, I had been a friend and student of Zachariah Sitchin, who taught me a lot about, you know, Sumerian history. And they actually used the winged imagery in Sumerian iconology as well.
Right.
I was attracted to it and it made sense. And I just, you know, decided this would be a good logo for the business. People would remember it.
Mm-hmm.
I've always been intrigued by Zachariah Sitchin. What did you make of his research? Did you find yourself being in line with everything he put out?
Well, probably not absolutely everything. He was very much a symbolist. And he came up with theories about this other planet, Nibiru, that he says this race called the Anunnaki lived on, and that when Nibiru came close to our planet, they basically, you know, flew from one planet to the other. That's a little bit of a stretch because Nibiru is still possibly its planet X, which we now know about, but we're not really sure.
Right.
But what impressed me about Zachariah was his scholarship and was his attention to Jewish history, because he grew up in a yeshiva in Israel, which is basically like a religious school where you study Bible alongside of mathematics and you know, language and other things like that. So he discovered when he went to college in London, he went to the London School of Economics. Across the street from that school is the British Museum.
Mm-hmm.
So I could tell that he was hanging out there a lot, and he got very interested in reading and translating cuneiform. And when he read and translated the cuneiform, he realized that very similar stories that were Bible stories were also being written in cuneiform. The names were changed. You know, some of the placements of the people were different. Like the story of Cain and Abel, or, you know, the story of Isis was there. So very interesting, like mythology was embedded in these cuneiform tablets of early history. And he began to realize that the story of our mythology of our solar system was also embedded in there. And that's the story of Genesis. So that's what impressed me. And I've read so many other people because of Zacharias. Mm-hmm. Like if you read his biography, you go back and you read some of the works of Barassus, you read Josephus Flavius, you read, Immanuel Velikovsky. Now the list goes on and on and on. Then you start to come up with your own cosmology, and from reading Zacharias' work, you become a cosmologist yourself, or a cosmogonist. There's many different terms for it, but you start to question and understand things differently.
Right.
And as a Jew, I became very fascinated with how Jewish history's timeline interfaces with what he wrote about. And that's what really impressed me. Like the beginning of the Jewish calendar was the end of the Anunnaki calendar. You know, we just celebrated the Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's, according to Zechariah, that was the beginning of Earth going back to humanity. And I think that's quite found and quite feasibly possible, that a progenitor came here, helped us get established laws, and then left. That's possibly quite feasible.
And yeah, and that's why I was asking about the symbol, because I became familiar with that, with the winged disc, reading some of the things that Zechariah Sitchin put out. You know, I see a lot of things that can't just be somebody that just randomly interpreted a tablet.
Well, actually, at the University of Pennsylvania, where they have a large collection of cuneiform tablets, they've actually created a dictionary, and they've done a lot of translations of the existing tablet and written books on the mythology that came out of Sumer. And their mythology is actually not that different than Zechariah's perspective.
Wow.
So he really wasn't that far off. He was pretty accurate, but just some of the links, some of the conclusions he drew, like because of this, then that means this. You know, he did make some extrapolations, which were a little extreme.
As you mentioned, there's a lot of things in his work that we can walk away with and definitely help us gain a better understanding, especially on that particular ancient civilization, which is so fascinating. Jennifer, one of the things that I know by looking at your website is that you also did a short 20-minute documentary film chronicling your trip to the south of England and looking at crop circles. Tell me a little bit about how crop circles get your attention.
Well, I'm a pattern recognizer and always have been. I came from a family of artists, and I appreciate sacred geometry. And you can't ignore the magnificent sacred geometry that's being presented in the fields for us, certainly in England. So I was fascinated by this. I needed to see it for myself firsthand. And Ruben Udiarte and I made a trip there in 2000. And it was a very, very profound, synchronistic, you know, journey into my understanding of what it's like when you follow a path and that path unfolds for you. It was just an incredible experience. And I came back convinced that something significant was going on in the fields of England and in probably in many other places. And we know crop circles are happening actually all over the world. They've been documented in over 60 countries. So I started to explore and investigate this, continuing to make trips every year to England, but I started to go into them in the United States and also in Canada as well. And I became so fascinated by it, friends started to say, Jen, will you like present on it? Will you show us your pictures? Tell us about your experiences.
Oh, that's awesome.
And then that led to me wanting to be able to present actually scientifically on the topic. So I prepared and read and studied, and I do a fairly decent presentation on them now. And in fact, I just did that in, I think I was in Exeter, New Hampshire 2 weeks ago at their UFO conference presenting.
Oh, that is very cool. Let me ask you about crop circles, because I haven't had the opportunity to see one or stand inside of one. And a lot of people that have, you know, been within the crop circle, they say that they can sense like a certain peace, or you know, they definitely feel different. Did you experience anything like that seeing these crop circles?
Yes, they're very alluring. It's very common to be drawn into them, almost like a bee is drawn into a flower. And all you want to do is lie down in the warm sun and go to sleep. I mean, it's like a hay or a bed for you, right? It's soft and it's squishy. And there's people from all over the world there playing, and, you know, children playing and dogs frolicking around, usually. It's a very joyful experience.
I've heard, like I said, from numerous people that have visited a crop circle site. It's definitely a different experience. I want to send a quick shout out to Tony Merlo, who says, great show so far, guys. Terrific guest. I'm in Vermont listening on my phone. Shout out to Tony. Thank you for tuning in on your phone all the way from Vermont. Let's go back to the documentary. You sent me a little note, and this was, I mean, for all of you, you know, aspiring filmmakers out there, you know, these are some of the challenges, I guess, you will have to overcome. Tell me what happened with a drone you guys were using for the filming.
Well, a lovely man named Gary Hilton offered to come up and do some shooting with Travis and I. Uh-huh. And I was, of course, looking to get incredible shots of the beautiful valley that you can see from the top of this plateau,
right,
where their event happened. If you go to the edge of the plateau, you can see for almost 50, 60 miles. And mm-hmm. I thought it would be really dramatic to like fly the drone right off the edge, because I could stand on the edge with my camera and shoot it, but not the same as shooting it from above where you can actually see this vista. And Gary Hilton reluctantly said, well, we have to be really careful because they can get caught in downdrafts. And the best time to go is like, you know, 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, right when the sun's coming up. So I said, no problem. Let's do it. Let's go. So we go out when it's very still, before the air turbulence starts, you know, and the sun was just coming up. And uh-huh. we get all set up and we fly this drone right off the cliff. And sure enough, it malfunctions and it drops.
Oh, my.
Right down into the canopy of the forest. And we thought, gosh, you know, we've just lost a pretty expensive piece of equipment. I mean, by the time you get a GoPro camera on them and mm-hmm. you get the GPS coordinates on them that you need, you know, you're looking at probably close to $2,000 that just dropped out of the sky. We were like, oh, gosh, that means, you know, does filming end? And fortunately, Gary has about 5 of them, so he had some other backups. But we did decide to go hunting for it. And Travis and I, you know, it was a complex thing. We ran back to the hotel. I mm-hmm. called Travis. I said, I think we need to go into the woods and try to find it. You don't really want to go into the woods without a plan, without
right.
a clear entrance point and a clear exit point, because it's easy to get lost. Mm-hmm. And if you run out of daylight, it gets cold up there at that
right.
elevation. And there are bears, there are wild boars, coyotes, you know, poisonous snakes, all sorts of stuff you have to worry about, poisonous spiders.
Right.
So Travis and I made a truck into the forest hoping that we could have a pretty good pinpoint mm-hmm. of where this thing went down, because I was also filming from the side of the cliff. So we had a pretty clear picture of where it was
uh-huh.
from the air. But of course, on the ground, finding it is like very difficult. Travis and I headed in. We both had 2 bottles of water. He had some firearms
oh
with
my.
Him, thank goodness, in case a bear came after
us.
And we basically spent the day in the woods looking for this thing and didn't find it and almost got lost ourselves. But
my.
We followed the sign of traffic and we got out to the highway before the sunset, which was good. And then we basically flagged a car down and got us to drive us back to camp, basically.
Oh, wow. Wow, that's quite the adventure.
It was a lost day. But that's where Travis and I got to know each other really well. Walking through the woods, looking up and talking about everything.
Right. I imagine that's the perfect way to bond. But it's funny because, you know, in the documentary, I believe Travis explains that area, a lot of it, it's just wilderness, right? Like nobody has gone through some parts of that massive, you know, landscape. It took a lot of courage for you guys to go in there and look for this drone. There was a question in the chat by Professor Madness, and it goes a little bit more on the technical side of things. So his question is, in regards to equipment, do you have a preference when it comes to filming? He was asking, you know, what's the worst camera you've ever used? So the flip side to that question for me would be, do you have a preference when it comes to shooting your documentaries?
Well, part of being a filmmaker is just keeping up with the technology that keeps changing
right.
all the time. I used to shoot analog, of course. I used mm-hmm. to love Sony cameras, but when they closed all their service centers and I worked with other filmmakers that were using Canon cameras, I started moving in and using Canons.
Right.
So now I'm a dedicated Canon user because they have much better color. And now I'm shooting digitally. So part of this film was shot on digital tape and part of it was shot you know, with what you call, you know, flash cards.
Right.
You know, and part of it was also shot on GoPro cameras.
Mm-hmm.
And even a little tiny, you know, small handheld digital camera that has a movie setting. And I would occasionally pop that on and a little bit even for my cell phone.
We live in an age where technology allows us to do so much. It can be a bit daunting sometimes. But, you know, it's really great because I know that, for example, with this documentary, what are some of the ways that people can see it? Because obviously we've talked a lot about it. Can people buy this or stream it? Where is this documentary available?
Well, right now, it's only really available for sale on my website, which is onwingsproductions.com.
Okay.
But you can see the screening list and you can go and see it either in some film festivals or UFO conferences. In fact, in Philadelphia, we're hosting a conference October 9th and 10th, and we're showing it for free, open to the public. And the MUFON National Symposium, which will be held in Irvine, California this year, just next week, the 24th, it starts Thursday the 24th, that evening, they're showing, or I will be there mm-hmm. showing the Travis film, and it's also free and open to the public. So anybody in Southern California can show up at Hotel Irvine and see the film and have Q&A. I think it'll be 7 o'clock on the 24th at that hotel.
Very cool.
But otherwise, they have to buy it. We probably will eventually put it to Vimeo and put it up mm-hmm. as a pay-per-view, but we haven't done that yet. But I'll be perfectly honest, what constantly happens is, you know, you have a good film when people post it illegally on YouTube.
Right.
And this film has had over 40 illegal posts.
Wow.
And I'm still, that's my new part-time job is trolling through the internet and sending out, you know, copyright infringement notices. And it's a freaking pain in the neck, but I have to do it to preserve the integrity of the film so I can eventually maybe get a network interested in it. But if it's up for free on the internet, people aren't going to do it.
Right.
And it's really quite nerve-wracking as a filmmaker because they have ads. YouTube embeds ads into
yeah.
them. So there's like Mitsubishi or, you know, Apple computers
right.
or different cars or, you know, colognes and drug companies all have their ads every 7 minutes plunked right into this documentary, and they had no right to take it and put it up. So it's quite frustrating.
Yeah, no, I bet. You mentioned earlier there's going to be a newer cut release, correct? You guys are doing some re-editing or something of that
yes.
nature?
Yes. I had originally hoped that I would have clear clearance on all the mm-hmm. footage in the film, and I used some archive footage from a production called UFOs Are Real. And this was co-produced by Stanton Friedman in
yeah.
1978. And that's how I learned about it. Stanton told me about it. And he said, you know, I went out there and I shot with this film crew from California. So I contacted the producers of that show and asked them if I could license their footage
mm-hmm.
and tried to negotiate with them. And they agreed at first, told me I could use the footage. We'd work out a contract. And then they kind of changed their mind after I'd had the film pretty much done. And they only gave me very, very limited licensing rights to use their footage. I can put it in film festivals. I can show it at UFO conferences.
Uh-huh.
I right now can't put it in a movie theater and charge admission.
Uh-huh.
I can't sell it to a major network like a History Channel or Discovery or Sci-Fi right now with that footage in it.
Right.
So for that reason, I am remaking a commercial version, but I will hold that version back for the purpose of selling it to a network or something like that and see where and how that can work. Because as a filmmaker, that's the only way I'll actually make my money back. Selling $20 or $25 DVDs here and there,
uh-huh.
even if you sell 20 at a conference and you go to 20 conferences, you're never going to make back
right.
the money that you spent to make the film. So I need to actually sell it in order to make another film.
Wow. You know, a lot of us don't realize how much work, time, money, blood, sweat, and tears go into making a documentary film. And I think when you take that into consideration, you realize how much it hurts when people, you know, illegally go about getting a copy of it. And again, it's not a victimless crime, as I guess a lot of times we like to think. But Jennifer, let me ask you, Travis is, like I said earlier, probably the biggest alien abduction case, in my opinion. Where can you go as a documentary filmmaker? Who would be your next subject if you were to continue this theme of documentaries?
Well, I think I have a crop circle film in me. It's, you know, been germinating for a long time. I have a lot of footage archived on that topic. I also probably would love to do a film about ancient sites that I've been to, because you can't go to some of these sites and stand there and think that there's not some piece of our history that's missing. If we built this, where and when and how, and if we didn't build it, who did? So I think Zachariah inspired in me a natural archaeologist that wants to really document in a new way, maybe a less searching for the right word, maybe not so much from the ancient alien perspective, but really from a logical approach of if we were to build this today, what would be involved and how complicated would it be? And how perfect was it that they built it so many thousands of years ago? And what does this mean about the culture that was there? I mean, there's a lot of direct logical information that we can draw from working with engineers and scientists. So I'm kind of, I have a Bachelor of Science in textiles. So I'm drawn to understanding the most logical, maybe you call it Occam's razor, you know, how do you get from here to there? There's lots of phenomenon that interest me. I'm also very interested in synchronicity and in consciousness and non-locality. So I may very well be drawn in that direction as well.
Can you tell me a little bit about synchronicity and how did you get familiar with that concept and why did you adopt it as something that is happening and it happens in our lives?
Well, I can give you a little story if we have the time.
Yeah,
when I was first going to England to research and study crop circles, I had signed up on a trip that was going to be like 35 people. I think I read something in the back of Nexus magazine and it was Beyond Boundaries or something like that. And I just kind of filled out the paperwork or went to a website and signed up. I had no idea who I was going with, but I knew I didn't know how to go to England on my own and find these crop circles. And as I was preparing for the trip, my husband called a friend in England and said, my wife's going to be tramping through private property. She's probably going to get arrested. And if she does, will you go and bail her out of jail since you live in England? She's a friend of mine. And the friend said, sure, no problem. I'll be sure to do that for you. And that day, this friend, his name is Richard, he goes home and in his local paper was a very interesting crop circle that had appeared that looked like a computer grid. My husband's company makes products that are along the lines of component pieces that could be inside computers. So for them to have this conversation and then for this friend to go home and find this crop circle that was like a computer grid was kind of synchronistic. So he sent it to me with a little note saying, Jen, you know, just be sure you have my number in your cell phone, because if you can only make one call, you know, you want to call the right person if you're in jail. And you know, by the way, you might want to check this formation out. So I get this newspaper article and I'm thinking to myself, oh, my goodness, I've got to get into this, you know, formation. This is amazing.
Right.
So I look at this and I immediately think, oh my, I've planned the totally wrong trip for myself. I'm a filmmaker. I'm going with my camera. I should have just hired somebody to be like my driver, to take me around, to introduce me to all the experts, to film the actual like digging up of the crops, the actual research, and if something is getting sent to Mr. Levengood, I'd really like to connect with Linda Howe and Nancy Talbot and Bert Jansen and, you know, some of the best experts on this topic.
Right.
And of course, you know, Colin Andrews. So I'm looking at this article. I'm thinking that I've booked the wrong trip. And the phone rings. And it's Ruben Udiarte who's leading the trip. And he says, Jen, I have some bad news for you. And I'm like, oh, no. What? He said, well, essentially, the trip's been canceled because everybody else canceled. It's only me going. I assume you don't want to go with me because you don't know me. We've never met, and you probably don't want to spend a week with a total stranger driving around the countryside in England.
Right.
And I started to cry. I said, are you freaking kidding me? Like, what? Everybody canceled? There were 35 people on this trip. How could everybody cancel?
Right.
But they did. It's a long story how they all canceled.
Wow.
So it was Ruben and I. Now, if that's not synchronistic, what is?
Wow.
So my first day there in England, I'm holding this article, right, with this picture. And he said, Jen, this is like driving Miss Daisy. Like, where do you want to go? Who do you want to meet? Right? I said, well, I want to get into this grid. I'd really like to meet Nancy Talbot. And at that moment, we're like pulling into a field and we're on a tractor path and we have to kind of pass another van that's coming towards us. So we kind of pull up on the side of the embankment and let this van pass us. But the van stops and rolls down the window and it's Nancy Talbot, whom Ruben knows.
Oh, wow.
And she says, Ruben, what are you doing tomorrow? I want to get into the grid. Can you bring your assistant?
Wow.
What the whole trip was.
Wow.
Was constant synchronicity. I was afraid to have a thought that was a negative thought for fear it would happen.
I was going to say that. I was going to ask you, what was your, you know, like your state of mind? Because when things fall into place, you know, obviously you get excited or whatever, but it's funny that you say that because that was also my same thought too. It's like, you know, when you're on a good streak, it's almost like you're scared to even like consider anything going remotely bad for that same fear.
We had that too on the trip.
Really?
Ruben and I were walking out of a crop circle at one point, and he had a fanny pack, which he hooked to his backpack because he didn't feel like having it around his waist anymore.
Right.
And as we were walking, the fanny pack was banging on his backpack. Now, we had a 2.5 to 3 mile walk from Adam's grave, where we were up high looking at some crop circles, back to where our car was parked. And we needed to get there before the sun went down. So we were kind of really, you know, hiking a good pace.
Right.
And I said to him 3 or 4 times, I said, Ruben, your backpack is bothering me. It's worrying me. Your fanny pack banging on your backpack. You're going to lose something. I just have this intuition. Something's going to fall out. You know, you should put it around your waist or put it inside your backpack. Don't hang it from your backpack. He said, no, it'll be fine. It'll be fine. And he like ignored what I was saying like 3 or 4 times. So we get to the car about 2 miles later, right? And he pops open the back of the trunk and swings his backpack off. And he realizes that his fanny pack was hooked to the zipper of his backpack. So as he was walking, it slowly unzipped his backpack.
Oh, wow.
And numerous things fell out of his backpack. Like his glasses that he needed to drive that night and his phone book. And he didn't know what else he lost, but he knew he lost a number of different things. Like he kept discovering what he had lost.
Oh,
well, he needed his glasses to drive at night. Yeah. And you're driving on the other side of the road
right
over there. And he didn't have them. And it was now dark.
Oh, my God.
So it was a little tricky.
It sounds like it was quite the adventure. But let me ask you about another thing I noticed on your website. And this is really interesting because I'm a bit familiar with Dr. Carol Rosen. I know a little bit about some of the things that she has spoken about. How did you connect with her? And can you tell me a little bit about this video that's on your website called Peace and Space Treaty, Dr. Carol Rosen Reads the Treaty?
Yes. Well, I was at the Open Minds Conference, which I've been going to ever since it started. I actually attended some of the international UFO congresses that were still in Lachlan as well. But I had heard Carol present, and I had brought my film equipment with me there because I had done a project for Kathy Martin, who is the niece of Betty and Barney Hill, and I needed to shoot an interview with Kathy Martin. So I had all my camera equipment, and I was out in Arizona at the Open Minds Conference, and I heard Carol present, and I was very, very moved by her desire to try to create a treaty that prevents us from putting nuclear weapons into space, and her desire to get, you know, multinations to agree to this, and mostly indigenous nations and small countries is where she's starting with this project, and then building pressure onto larger countries, eventually like the United States, to abide by this treaty, because there's a lot of unknowns and unpredictable things with space. That we would probably be better off not having nuclear weaponry there. But there's a lot of debate about that. And she was forewarned by Von Braun, whom she worked with at NASA, that this would become an issue. Somehow he saw things that were going to be planned that he knew NASA was working on. And he was very worried about some of their plans. And he encouraged Carol to take up this cause after he was gone and to try to work towards this mission. Now, I'm, you know, a person who believes that peace can be achieved. I believe in dialogues. That's why I did the disclosure dialogue with Ron James, another production I won Ebbies for. I traveled enough with people, which was a peace movement in the 70s. So I felt that if I could help Carol in any way, I would try to. Wow. And I sat her down and said, tell me about this. I'll do some web videos for you, and you can put them up on your website, because people want to see things. They want to, they don't want to read. They want a little video. So I made her three different videos, and Chris O'Brien helped me very much with this. And my goal was also to go around and interview some of the other people who were involved in the treaty, like Edgar Mitchell, which I have done now. And I believe we have a re-edit of that, which it may have been posted, maybe it's not. But, you know, that has Edgar Mitchell in this little piece. So that's what it's about. And that's how I got started on it.
Yeah, Dr. Carol Rosen, I remember watching one of her videos a few years back talking about how, you know, she knew Bernard von Braun and this plan to weaponize space, and talking about, you know, something about the last card being the alien invasion card or something, I think along those lines. And it was, I mean, you know, I'm familiar with the story of Bernard von Braun, you know, Project Paperclip and all that. So hearing her talk about something like that, it was really interesting, because this is kind of where my conspiracy hat comes out. And I'll say that, you know, I believe that NASA, especially during those years, you know, they were doing a lot of things that we didn't, and we still don't know about, at least in my opinion. And that's why I found her statements so interesting. So it's really cool that you helped her out to put some of these videos up, because, you know, some of the information that she has is really, really interesting and really great. I know that we're almost out of time, so let me ask you, I just got a couple more questions. One of them is, why did you decide to make this documentary? You mentioned something a minute or two ago when we were talking about these videos with Dr. Rosen, that, you know, people don't like to read anymore. Was that your principal motivation, or at least your initial motivation to make a documentary film?
Well, I, of course, was attracted to the veracity of the story. You know, who wouldn't want to make this film? I just didn't know if I was capable. I hadn't really done a film like this before, and it was complicated to actually undertake it. And I had to take it apart in stages. But once I started taking it apart in pieces, and I started looking at what the pieces were that I had in place, I realized that I had it all. I just had to kind of swim through what I call the data nightmare, because, you know, these days doing a film, it's all data files, and you have to know where the file is, where it's stored, what it's named, how to access it, how to reconnect it, what happens when you lose it, you know.
Right, of course.
And it's easier in some ways, but much more complex in others, because when something goes wrong, I don't know how to fix it. I have to call in a tech support person or whatever. And I also knew that I didn't have a drone. I didn't know how to fly one. I knew I was going to want some aerial photography. And I was very, very gifted in this film that people came together to help me, like Gary Hilton and Ben Hansen and a guy by the name of Will Kriebel, who did some artwork for the project. And, you know, just many people from many walks of life. Stepped up. I had some wonderful young editors in California who worked with me that took my 4 to 5 to 7 hour film, depending on which files you were looking at. And they honed them down to 1.5 hours for me in a way that I wasn't able to do, and in a really brilliant way.
Wow.
And helped turn the story into a personal, you know, journey of Travis. And a personal interest story rather than just a UFO story.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
If you had to summarize it, what would you say your mission statement here is? You know, what are you hoping will change in the world with input, you know, such as documentaries like this? You know, what do we want to see?
My goal with the Travis film mm-hmm. was to make a film that was a breakthrough film. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping that this film is one that makes it, and it is making it now, into mainstream film festivals where a wider audience is looking at this, not just people who have gone to a UFO conference.
Right.
And looking at a UFO film at a UFO conference. My goal is to have it play in a lot of mainstream film festivals. If it wins enough awards, it will make it into the art houses, and it mm-hmm. will play in art house films, you know, theaters.
Right.
And I think if it can do that, it can, you know, of course, stimulate interest again in the Travis story, and that will help Travis. It'll help him sell more books. It'll give him more speaking engagements. So in that way, I will be helping Travis, which is a nice thing to be able to do.
Of course.
But I also want to bring the younger generations who you think, oh, that was 40 years ago. That was long before I was born. How can that be important? It's so very much important.
Right, of course. And Jennifer, we're almost out of time, but we got to let people know about this. September 24th, Thursday at 7:30 p.m., there's going to be an event, correct? And it's going to be the screening of the...
Yeah, well, it's the free pre-screening.
So,
yeah.
Right.
For the people who are listening to us here in Southern California, you're all going to definitely want to check it out. It's, I'm telling you, an amazing, amazing documentary. And if I remember correctly, you said there will be a Q&A, right? You will be there?
Yes, there will. Yes, there will. We'll have Lee Spiegel there. We'll mm-hmm. have Ben Hansen. Ron James will be there. I'll be there. Travis, I think, will be there.
Very cool.
Have Stanton Friedman and Kathy Martin there. So a lot of people that are in the film will be there, and you can meet them, and we're going to do a dialogue. We'll go, the film will end at about 9:30, quarter mm-hmm. of 10, and we'll do the Q&A as long as they'll let us be in the room. So certainly an hour, you know, maybe a little longer.
Right. That's awesome. That's amazing. So definitely people get out there. That's going to be in Irvine. It's not too far from LA. And if you're in Orange County, you're already in the neighborhood. So definitely check that out. Jennifer, the website is onwingsproductions.com. And Wings is spelled W-I-N-G-E-S. Onwingsproductions.com. And that's where people can go and get more info on the documentary and all the other stuff that you're working on, the stuff you've done. And of course, the other website that people need to check out is the skyfiresummit.com, correct? And why don't you give people the details for that?
That will be in Heber, Arizona, which is about a 2.5 to 3 hour drive from the Sky Harbor Airport in Phoenix. So you fly to Sky Harbor and then uh-huh. Rent a car, or probably that's the best way because you really can't take public transportation up there.
Mm-hmm.
But it will be at the Bice Ranch, which is right on the main route that comes through Heber, Arizona. And Heber is the closest place to the actual abduction site that took place for Travis 40 years ago.
Oh, wow.
So it'll be in a lovely barn, it's a refurbished barn where we'll hold the conference.
Right.
You can stay at accommodations right there at Bison Ranch, and that's all on the website. And there'll be 2 days of fabulous speakers and a visit up to the site with Travis during the day. And there'll be a night watch from the parking lot,
mm-hmm.
Which is wonderful, with incredible equipment. Ben Hansen does the most amazing night sky watches for anyone who's never been to one. It's quite an event. You won't want to miss that.
No, it sounds like it's going to be a lot of fun to be out there and just, commemorating that, you know, what happened on that fateful night in November 5th, 1975 to Travis and his crew. Jennifer, I can't even begin to express how thankful we are that you could join us tonight. It's been a pleasure talking to you and, you know, learning more about this film. And I really hope that people, you know, are motivated to go out and watch it, because it's great. It's full of a lot of interesting information that, like I said, you know, I've read the book, I've read numerous interviews and watched tons of clips, but the documentary still, you know, 40 years later, offers some really interesting and new insight and information that at least I didn't know about.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you so much, Jennifer, for being with us tonight. We really, really appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you both for having me on. It was my great pleasure.
Thank you so much. And we'll be in touch, Jennifer. Have a great, well, for you, it's early morning. Thank you for staying
yes,
up so late with
you.
Us.
You're welcome. It's been a pleasure.
Bye-bye.
Good night.
Good night. Good night.
Wow. That was
a lot to pack
literally,
in. A lot
you
to
know,
pack into a brain.
Yeah, it exceeded my expectations. I'll tell you that much. It was great. It was an amazing interview.
Bear in mind, expectations were already high.
Oh, yeah.
Because that can mean two things.
You're so bad. I want to thank everybody that tuned in. By the way, I really appreciate everybody that also took the time to keep us company here. And I'm just thanking Jennifer really quick before, you know, I let her go completely from our cyber connection here. I really appreciate everybody that took the time to tune in. Like I said, this is a case that's very, you know, from childhood, it has fascinated me, caught my attention, made my mind wander. And it's always very humbling to get a chance to talk to Travis and discuss this case. And obviously, tonight we had the added company of Jennifer Stein, who directed this incredible documentary that I think, again, if you're in the Southern California area this week, you want to make it down there. And it's free.
I know, right? I mean, everyone loves free stuff anyway.
I know, I do. Considering movies cost like $20 nowadays.
Yeah, I mean, if you live
plus
within
popcorn.
Driving distance, it's worth it.
Yeah, seriously. It's like you need a second job nowadays to go to the theater. Just catch a movie. So definitely try to make it out to everyone. Skyfiresummit.com is the website. If you want to check out the event, I believe they still got tickets left. If you want to make it out there, Arizona,
well,
and check
quite,
it out.
Yeah, a few of our listeners are already from the more...
Yeah.
Not really England, southern England.
Easter side of the... Yeah.
But it's like in the center, right? I think.
I feel like geography. I don't even know where I'm
from. I'm not from here, so...
But anyways, definitely check it out. Skyfiresummit.com. And also travis-walton.com is the website where you can order the book. His book sells for quite a lot. Like if you go to Amazon and certain vendors, his book is quite expensive. But if you go to his website, he'll even sign it for you. So get it from him. And of course, be on the lookout. Maybe we'll get that special edition Fire in the Sky Blu-ray sometime in the near future as well, right? So I want to thank Travis Walton for being with us. Jennifer Stein, thank you so much for being with us. And if you miss any part of this show, you will find it on our website in the next day or two, along with a nice little write-up courtesy of our very own Genevieve Yue. And if you haven't already, the tables were turned on us, and we were actually guests on Ground Zero with Clyde Lewis. I haven't had that much fun in a long time, except Sunday nights. That's the only time.
No, check it out. If you go to groundzeromedia.org or just, you know, Google Ground Zero Media, you can see the interview we have on there or on SoundCloud, or just go to WOTRradio.com. You'll find it straight up there at the top.
Definitely check that out. So that being said, as always, Engineer Frank on Twitter, West of the Rockies on Facebook, Genevieve Yue on Twitter, also at No Added Flavors, O-U-R-S at the end, Thursday nights, right here, same channel, same place. Send your requests, jokes, facts, and anything else you want her to talk about, do, or whatever. Find us at WOTR Radio is our Twitter. WOTRradio.com is the website. And because a lot of people were telling me, oh, we don't have access to iTunes or whatever, and now you can get the show on Stitcher, TuneIn, and now Spreaker. So have at it, kids. Take your pick.
Any.
Any of those. And more coming soon as more people kind of jump on this stuff that we call West of the Rockies. That being said, take care. Be safe. God bless. Don't do anything too crazy. We want to see you back next week. Genevieve, thanks so much for tonight.
Good night, everyone out there.
And we're going to go out with a little nighttime music. I haven't played this song in a while.
Is that Lullaby?
It'll put you to sleep in a good way. Enjoy this one. We'll see you next week.
The Independent FM Radio, Los Angeles.